I'm going to teach you three levels of rain animation in After Effects. We are going to increase the difficulty level as we climb the evolutionary tree, not only by using more advanced techniques, but by using basic techniques in smarter and smarter ways. So in 8 mode, we'll go over to our effects and presets panel and type in rain to see if anything comes up. And here we have CC rainfall. That sounds just like what we want. Let's add that to a black solid, and that's certainly rain, but we can make it look much better. Let's bump up the opacity to see it a little more, and the size too. Now it also reflects the background by default, which makes it a bit harder to see. So let's turn that influence all the way down. And let's also put a lovely gradient behind our rain and change the rain's blending mode from normal to screen to see behind it. Let's turn the drops quite a bit down as well. And this effect has two really amazing tricks up its sleeve. The first is speed. The speed controls how fast or how slow the raindrops fall, and also their length as well. The faster they are, the more the raindrops smear, and we get these bigger lines for the raindrops. When it's really slow, they are just circles. And we can animate this for a nice speed ramp. So let's keyframe this starting really high. Let's go to 15,000. There we go, very fast, keyframe that there. And then about 2 seconds later, let's really lower it to maybe 150. Let's add a bit of easing, and look at that. And I'm also not too keen on the rain all going in very slightly different directions. So let's turn the spread from 6 down to 0. So now they're all going straight downwards. And at the really slow speed, we can see the second great thing about this effect. And that is that there is depth. Depth in 3D space. These drops have parallax. The drops that are closer are a little larger and they move faster, which is harder to see in the chaos, but you really do notice it once they start to slow down. And we can adjust that with the scene depth. Let's increase it a little bit more. Let's not go crazy. And in our extras, we can enhance that even more with the ground level percentage. So if we adjust this, we can see some of the raindrops are disappearing, and this is where they would hit the ground and disappear. So we get even extra depth there. And we can create a simple splash animation for each of these raindrops. So I'll grab my ellipse tool, create an ellipse, and animate it, increasing its size and fading out. And even at the ape level, we know to animate an ellipse's size and not its scale. That way we can keep its stroke width consistent. Now we can trim that layer, place it where one of the raindrops disappears, and we've got a convincing little splash. Now we can pre-compose that splash and drag that wherever the drops disappear. There, we get a lovely, peaceful, rainy scene with a speed ramp and lots of depth. Not bad for an ape. I will be honest though, timing all of those splashes took ages, so I only did half the screen, which you can only really get away with if your animation is from the POV of a pirate. But you know what they say, you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. I know monkeys aren't apes. For the elevated ape, we're after a more cool and stylized rain effect. And much like our ancestors, we are leaving the trees and gonna take our attention to the ground, how the raindrops interact with it, but this time in a much smarter way. We're evolving. I was inspired by this image, thinking that those two colors with the rings overlapping into the alternate color looked really cool. The first way I tried to do this was with a single ripple comp with three circles expanding, then fading away. They each have a drop shadow, so there's a black and white version of each circle. I put a bunch of those comps in a line and then over a background. Then I added just a couple of effects, a threshold to restrict it to either black or white, and then a tint to recolor it. Now this isn't too bad. The core idea is there, but it would need a fair bit more attention to get it looking the way I wanted. And I found an easier way. I discovered the effect CC Drizzle. And this is what it looks like by default. It has all those ripples randomly and has that interaction when they overlap. Exactly what we want. Now let's start from scratch in a new comp. We'll create a new solid with Ctrl plus Y. We'll make it gray, but we'll make the height about 3 times larger than our comp. And I'll explain why soon. Add the drizzles to that. We'll increase the drip rate a little bit more to 8 to fill up our larger solid. Open up the shading, and we'll increase the diffuse lighting to the max so we can see more of the detail of the ripples. And we will need this a bit darker, so let's take down the ambient light to maybe 15 or so. Now, to make these look like we are looking at them from a lower angle and not directly above, what we can do is unlink the scale of this layer and then lower the vertical scale, squashing it. This is why we started with that comp being much taller, so we can scale it down without running out of layer. Then on a new adjustment layer, which we are going to rename to effects because we always label our layers. Let's add the threshold effect. And this starts really shaping it into that final look we want that will just be two colors. Now I do want a clear separation of light and shadow in here. And we can do that by on our drizzle layer, opening up the light properties and changing it from distant light, which is kind of far away and lighting everything evenly, to point light, which lights only in a specific area. And let's move that light position to the very center of our comp. And we can lower the light height as well, so it shines on a smaller and smaller area. And the light is still catching a lot of these ripples far away from the light. But if we do lower the ripple height, that should get rid of a lot of those. I don't want a few, but not too many. There, now we're getting very close. And we can also adjust the light intensity as well to grow and shrink how much of that area is illuminated, and just tweak all of these values. The ambient light, the diffuse as well, just to hone in on the look we want. I like it around this level. Now to make it a bit more moody, let's add some more effects. A lot of my very frequently used favorites, let's add a tint to recolor it. We'll map the black to a very, very dark gray and the white to a pure blue. We'll add a bit of Gaussian blur to soften it, and we'll treat ourselves to a deep glow. You do have to be subtle though. Hominids are more than capable to use tools very skillfully. So do remember, if you're walking upright, keep the glow light. And if you don't have deep glow, a few regular glows are just fine. We'll add a transform effect with a wiggle on the position property to add that tiny shake for some gate weave. I talked a lot about that in my last video. Good old posterize time to set the frame rate to 12 frames per second, and then some grain with some noise HLS auto. And for some extra atmosphere, let's add some raindrops falling that might catch this light. So I'll grab the pen tool and just draw a line coming straight down. We'll animate its shape path. We only need to do that over about 3 keyframes, I'll say. I'll make them all hold keyframes, so there's no blending in between them, and we get something like that. And let's put that under the adjustment layer, and we'll set its blending mode from normal to difference. This way it'll show the inverse of what's underneath it. So when it's on top of black, it'll become blue, and when it's on top of blue, it'll become black. Well, it will all be black and white, but the tint will be turning it into blue or black. Now let's move the anchor point to the very bottom of that layer, hit R on our keyboard, and adjust the rotation of that drop to have it coming in from any angle we like. And we can get really smart with this. Let's duplicate this layer. Let me just nudge that over for a second. And on the rotation of this raindrop, I'm simply gonna get the pick whip and select the rotation of our first one. So now they are linked. And every duplicate I make, the rotation can be adjusted from that original one. So the direction will be consistent across every raindrop we make. Now that's evolution, baby. Let's spread them out across the scene. There, I'm not trying to match the ripples, just match the vibe. Now that's something I could lo-fi study and relax to. And if we turn that effects layer on and off, we can see just how much those effects are shaping the result. The threshold effect in particular. I am absolutely threshold pills at the moment. It's such a great effect for pulling interesting 2D stylized looks out of 3D looking effects that just don't quite get there on their own. No disrespect to a CC drizzle or all my drizzlers out there. And before we get to the very highest third evolutionary level of rain, let's split the evolutionary line where apes now have full control over the planet and take the core of this effect to push it even further. So I thought this effect could make a really cool movie title, but maybe an 80s horror film. So I slapped some text over the top, changed its blending mode again to difference. And when I tried a bolder weight, I loved how the ripples kind of came in and out of the text. The difference inverting them right next to one another made it look a bit kind of checkerboardy and not natural at all. But I knew I could do a much better job with just a few changes. So instead of laying the text over the ripples, let's use the shape of the ripples themselves to warp the letters using a displacement map. So let's change their blending mode back to normal. And we want to add the effect displacement map to that text layer. Now for our displacement map layer, we want to use our drizzle layer and make sure we use the effects and mask as the source because those ripples are being made by that drizzle effect. And now we can also hide that drizzle layer, but we'll need a background. I'll quickly make a black background with a solid. And we can also hide those raindrops for now. Can barely see it now, but if we increase the amount of horizontal displacement, we can start to see the effect working. The darker values in that drizzle layer are warping our text layer to the right. It's technically using the red values for the displacement here, but because our drizzle layer is grayscale, the red, the green, the blue give the same result. true equality. And now it looks like our text is either on or underneath some water that is being disturbed by those ripples, which is exactly what we want. There's just two things we need to correct. First is that the pin light, which is making it brighter in the middle, is kind of warping the center. So on our drizzle layer, let's change that light from point light to distant light. We can hide it again, put our effects back on. That sorts that out. And now our ripples are back to being perfect circles as seen from above. Which is okay, that works fine if you want that, but I want these to appear at an angle. Now this is happening because our displacement map effect is not taking into account that we've squashed the scale on that drizzle layer. So we can easily fix that just by pre-comping this drizzle layer and making sure we move all attributes to the new composition. And now our ripples are nice and squashed because that displacement map is looking at a comp that has squashed layers inside it. Now we can tweak the ripples to get the effect we want. There, now it's looking really like it's under some water. Another thing you might have noticed is that the displacement map is pushing our layer out of the center a bit down and to the right. Now we could just nudge it back into the center and eyeball it to get it in the middle, but that wouldn't be very Dr. Zaius of us now, would it? To keep this and any other layers we might want to use in the center, all we need to do is go into that drizzle pre-comp and make this background a perfect 50% gray. At the moment, it is a little bit darker, so it is displacing everything to the right, but if it's a completely neutral 50% gray, just the ripples will affect the text, not the darkness of the background. Now, I find the easiest way to do this is to just create a shape layer, make sure its color is exactly 50% gray, and then adjust the ambient shading on that drizzle to match. Now, as hominids, we have traded our night vision for incredible color perception, so this should be no trouble at all. And now we don't need the shape layer anymore, so we can just fling that off onto onlooking bystanders. And back in our main comp, our text is centered beautifully. We can bring back those raindrops, maybe move them into some new positions. I do want to make sure they are on top of our text as well. And then think of the perfect title for an 80s slasher movie. Now, the most important skill in any motion design project is problem solving. Figuring out what you want to communicate and how to achieve that with design and animation. Over the last 5 years, I've been teaching that to thousands of motion designers. I've created 3 courses that cover animation from absolute beginner to an advanced level and the design process in ridiculous detail as well. Not just executing like a motion designer, but thinking like one too. If you want to level up your motion design skills, I've spent a year building each of these courses to help you do that as quickly and effectively as possible. I teach a structured format that builds on each skill while creating new projects for your portfolio at each stage. And we've created some incredible student collab projects as well. You'll also save hundreds of dollars when you bundle courses together, and in the end, you might just explode. They're all on benmarriott.com. Come and learn motion design with me. When our consciousness finally escapes its physical form and we can perceive every possible creation imaginable, we can achieve some pretty nice animation in After Effects. So I recently made this chili animation. I painted this chili and animated over it to match the painterly texture. This was done frame by frame and took ages, so I would not use that process again. Instead, for this video, I wanted to create something similar, but more detailed and with a bit more of a cleverer process in After Effects. If you're curious about this, here's the 20 second process that I took. I did the roughs in Calipeg on my iPad. I wanted to do the cleanup in Procreate Dreams, but I forgot it didn't have a selection tool until it was too late and I had already done a bunch. So I then had to move it again into Photoshop to clean it up. Then I added text and texture in After Effects. This is also included in that project file if you want to dig around in there. So I found a nice satisfying slow motion raindrop video to use as a reference. And this really has 2 main components: the water drop falling and the ripples. The raindrop is just a circle with a gradient, and we also have a gradient background too. I kept everything in grayscale because we can color those with effects later. For the ripples, I figured I could create a single one and then duplicate that for all the others. So we'll start with that one first. This is what the final result of that looks like. And this was a bit of a repetitive process with a fair bit of experimentation to get this look. So instead of going through it step by step, which would take much too long and be very boring, I'm going to walk you through what each one of these layers does and what they're adding to this effect. Again, everything is included in the project files. So this is in a separate comp. Now the background is gray, but that is just so we can see this clearly. If we turn the transparency on, we can see that it is just these ripples and their shading. That's so that when we start stacking the ripples, we can see the ones underneath. So let's remove everything back to the first layer, pretty much the only animation in this whole thing, which is a single ellipse, increasing its size, and I've got a few keyframes on its stroke width as well. Just expanding and easing in pretty slowly. I'll put the background back on and I have two effects on that. I have a Gaussian blur just for some initial softening, and then I have a directional blur as well, which softens it more horizontally. And that's to create a bit more of a tapering effect as this kind of rolls off the edges into the sort of the flat plane of the water, or at least give that illusion. Then I created a duplicate version of that layer and lowered it down. So this sits underneath and is even more blurred to get more of that tapered look. So it's a bit sharper at the top and softer at the bottom. And that is the main shape we're working with. Then for a highlight, I added another duplicate, this time colored it white and really shrank down the stroke width. And for this one, I added two masks. So now only this top left section and this bottom right section of that highlight are visible. Those masks are also feathered as well, so we don't have a harsh line. This comp is all about keeping everything soft. Then some more blurs back on top of those. And then I did the same thing for the shading. This is just a dark layer, this time lower down, feathered masks as well in those same areas, and then blurs back on top. This I did set to preserve underlying transparency, so it is only affecting the pixels underneath. If we turn transparency back on, here that is off, and it is sort of creating more pixels. But if we turn this on, it is restricted to just the existing pixels underneath. Everything else that's transparent is preserved. Then I did two more versions of that layer, each one moving it slightly down and making it a little bit softer. Then I put an adjustment layer over everything and animated a directional blur and a Gaussian blur to blur it out even more as it gets wider, so it gets softer and softer, flattening into the water. Now, the ultimate way to soften it was to actually add the gradient background from our main comp over the top of everything and then have that slowly fade in. So by the end of this comp, it will look exactly like the background. And then a preserved underlying transparency on that so that, again, it only affects our ring and not the rest of the comp. And then the last thing to make it even softer was just to add a few more duplicates of layers and slightly darker grays, which did expand out a little bit from the ring to kind of make it look like they are maybe casting shadows and just make it super, super soft. And here's how that looks back in our main comp. It gets softer and then fades out nicely. Then it was time to animate the raindrop, first just falling down. And of course we want it to enter the water. So I added a mask, which is just a shape layer with a slight blur on it, and use that as a mat for our raindrop layer. I animated the position of our raindrop to jump up and down, I think about 3 times. And each time it jumps up and down, it gets smaller. Just animating its scale so it loses some mass while it is underneath the water. And then on the last one, it kind of lands on the surface of the water above the mat. And then I actually parented it to a null, then animated that null scale to kind of squash and stretch as if it was just bouncing on the surface before it finally fades in under the water. I created duplicates of the ripples and lined them up for whenever the circle entered or exited the water. Now having the ripple layer on top means that it covers the ripple layer underneath, which I did not want. So to get around that, what I did was create a mask, which cuts that layer in half, feathered that mask a little bit, then duplicated that layer, inverted that mask. So now these two layers have either side of that ripple and drag the ripple on the bottom underneath that previous layer in the layer stack. So now it looks stacked in the right order. I did that a whole bunch of times, adding extra ripples in between the bounces and just timing those to make sure they all aligned up nicely. That created a few extra layers, but nothing too out of hand. I also added a shadow to the raindrop, which is just an ellipse with some blurs on it. And for the final colors and effects, I added a Gaussian blur, and that just unifies that very sharp circle with everything underneath it. Some grainy noise with noise HLS auto, and then I colored it with CC toner. Now another extra effect I tried, and you might be after, is a slight strobing to the whole animation. So this is created with another adjustment layer over the top of everything. I have a curves effect on it, and I have its opacity animated to go from 100 to 0, back to 100 with a looping expression on that. And this curves effect is really subtle. We don't want to have to put a warning on our animation. And this kind of mimics a light source flickering when filmed with an extreme slow motion camera. I'm not sure if it's necessary for this animation, but it is a really useful, strong visual cue that you're watching something in slow motion. So a good and really simple trick to keep up your sleeve if you ever want to lean into that. Most of these rain techniques and skills we've covered have so many applications beyond rain. Layers of feathered masks and blurs can create softer gradients and satisfying shading to anything. Displacement maps can warp any layer based on the values of another. Threshold can turn gray messes into bold designs, and CC rainfall can make rain fall. We have gone from knuckle dragging to neurons bragging and made a troop of friends along the way. Please let me know if you'd like me to tackle any other type of animation in 3 levels. And if you want to learn more techniques to put your motion design in ape mode, check out this video.
I love you, Dr. Zaius! Thank you. It's great to be back.